John, this represents a lot of your life here. You spent a lot of time working on your dissertation here.
I did. I spent some summers here collecting fish, studying the layers, went on multiple field trips up here with the school I was attending. So this place is like home to me.
Uh-huh. Can you show me some of the stuff you were working with?
So we're in a commercial quarry here. It's a place where they dig these fish out and they sell them. Mm-hmm. And I think if we break some of these layers of rock open, we'll find some fish.
I'm hoping that happens. Yeah.
So what we're gonna do is go in right along a seam right in here, and you can see how this whole thing is
lifting up here.
Yeah, it's a big slab. And just kind of get your fingers underneath there. And so now what we're gonna do is we're gonna take some of these chisels. Yeah, we're gonna split down through this and see what we can find.
Is this what your research assistants did, hold the rock while you?
That's right, all day long.
Oh yeah, look
at
that.
At least three fish here.
Yeah.
So there's one there, one right there. Another one there, another one there.
Oh my goodness.
That was a good break right there.
Yeah.
So these all look like nidia, just a little herring type fish. Boy, that one is a really nice one right there.
Yeah, it is.
The edge right here, you can see multiple layers in here.
Yeah, I do.
And they're not very thick. They're almost as thick as playing cards.
Uh-huh.
And the conventional idea is that each pair of a layer, a dark layer and a light layer, lasted a year. But you look at fish like this guy down here, I do not see a single bone out of place. Fins are nice and splayed out right there. And based on my fish experiments, that thing sank down to the bottom of the lake and was buried in a calcium carbonate layer within a day after it laid down to the bottom. And I think that's the only way that you can explain such good preservation.
Sure.
And not only we see it there, but that fish, and that fish, they all have really exceptional preservation, and they have to be buried quickly.
Yeah, there was really just a lot of fine detail in that fossil there. So those small, tiny layers that we're looking at here, those are not annual layers.
I don't see any way that they could be annual layers based on how well they're preserved. Yeah, I would think almost daily layers here. Something was different about the water chemistry here in that it was precipitating a lot of this calcium carbonate out, which was covering the fish.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing that's really interesting about this particular outcrop is there's several volcanic ash beds in here. And so the volcanoes are nearby, maybe some of the ones up in Yellowstone, they would erupt. And the ash would settle down through the lake, and here's this nice orange layer right here. That would be one volcanic ash bed. Here's another orange layer, not as thick. That would be another one. Here's another volcanic ash right here. And here's another ash bed that's maybe an inch and a half thick.
Right.
And so, of course, the volcanic eruptions are daily things, maybe hourly things, and sending ash over this entire landscape. And sometimes you find fish fossils below these volcanic ash beds or other things preserved right under the ash. But, you know, here's some evidence of the rapid processes that are taking place in this lake. Not just the formation of all these layers in here, but you see the volcanic ash in here. This is kind of interesting. We see some darker layers up here.
Yes.
Some of these layers are actually oil rich. So some of these are actually considered oil shales. And if you take this and break it open a little bit. You can actually smell the petroleum in there a little bit. These oil shales speak of the organic input into this lake by algae and other things.
Uh-huh. So if these are, as you were saying, rapid, then these volcanic eruptions are within months of each other or so.
Yeah, the Yellowstone volcanoes, we think those are post-flood. There's been some famous creation studies done on those, but this is probably the area where some of these volcanic ash beds may have come from. There's a few other locations, but that's one of the possibilities. There are some closer volcanoes than the Yellowstone events, but the Yellowstone events are known to have produced ash beds that covered everything west of the Mississippi in some cases. So So Del, these ash beds actually help us to tell time in the lake.
How's that?
So, you know, this ash bed is a single event, maybe laid down in a day or even less, maybe in hours. Here's another ash bed, and so on. And if we can trace these ash beds and confidently know that they're the same from place to place in the lake basin, for example, we can look at this thickness between those two ash beds right there, and we know that that thickness of Green River formation was laid down at the same time, whether we're right here in this spot or over at the edge of the lake. And it happens that we know these aren't yearly events because you can find these two ash beds. You can find this ash bed here, count the layers, find it at the edge of the lake, and at the edge of the lake, the thickness is more.
Huh.
And so—
Is that more layers?
More layers at the edge of the lake, and that's because you have more sediments and whatnot coming in from the edge of the lake. And so we know these aren't yearly laminations. We know—
Right, that wouldn't make sense.
The laminations are not equal from here to there. There's about 30% more layers at the edge of the lake than there is in the middle. So one of the things I was able to do with my research is I collected fossil fish between two of these ash beds. And I collected fossil fish in two sites near the middle of the lake and fossil fish from two sites out at the edge of the lake. And I don't know exactly how much time is represented between those ash beds, but one thing I do know is that the time is the same, whether it be weeks, months, or years between those ash beds. I know that there's the same amount of time. And so I was able to study the fish and the decay of the fish and the preservation of the fish during the same time in the lake's history. And so that's what I worked on as part of my dissertation project.
What was the sum of your conclusion from all of that?
Well, I wanted to understand how these fish were so well preserved. And so what I did is I did experiments in the lab with real fish, and it really didn't matter what kinds of conditions I chose, whether it be water temperature, water depth, salinity, the amount of oxygen in the water. Fish decompose quickly. And I looked at a number of dead fish in some modern settings as well, and you find the same thing. But when you come here to Fossil Basin, a lot of these fish are so well preserved. They had to be covered up within a week, even to preserve a fish that's falling apart. You need to bury it pretty quickly.
Yeah.
And if it's not buried quickly, then it's not preserved.
Yeah.
So I think the take-home point is that the fossil fish and the other fossils here show that these sediments were laid down rapidly. Yes, it was after the flood, but even after the flood, we have processes that produce fast layers.
Yeah. So for a geologist, what we're looking at is a history book, right? Most of us have to read history written in words, but you're reading history in the rocks.
Yeah.
Well, John, what brought you here to this place? Well, what made you choose this amazing basin?
Well, I think it's a number of different factors. When I was working on my master's degree at Institute for Creation Research, I ran across some fossil fish from Connecticut. There's fossil fish in other layers besides the Green River formation. But I was interested in the fish there, and I mused a little bit in my thesis about, you know, the only way you could make these fish is by rapid burial. But then I decided to do PhD work at Loma Linda. And several of the professors at Loma Linda were working right here in Fossil Basin. And the professors approached me with several different projects that I could work on, but this project in particular really interested me. And I had a professor that studied taphonomy. Taphonomy is the study of the decay of organisms and everything that happens to them before they become a fossil. So I had a professor, that was his expertise, and another professor, his expertise was the rocks in this basin. He had spent a whole career working on these rocks. And so two of my committee members were the perfect people to come out here and look at this.
Yeah.
And so I was interested, not only as a scientist, but as a creationist, how these rocks fit into Earth history. And as I began to think about it, and as I learned the layers of the rock out here, the stratigraphy and so on, I began to understand the best explanation perhaps for these was in a post-flood setting. Mm-hmm. And so I've done some writing on this explaining, you know, why I think these are post-flood rocks, and even have proposed some methodology about how we can think through about whether something is a flood rock or a post-flood rock. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the big lessons that we learn here is that this is a basinal deposit. It doesn't extend across the United States like the Coconino sandstone extends across, you know, most of the western states. But this deposit is fairly localized, and it's not been deformed. It's not folded like the other rocks are down below it. It doesn't extend across. You see a complete ecosystem present here. And so those are the kind of things where I really began to think about these rocks and try to understand them within a biblical model of Earth history.
Yeah. You know, John, one of the things that has really impressed me in the privilege I've had to interview you and Dr. Austin, Dr. Snelling, and all of these incredible scientists is that you're not content with just sitting in an office somewhere, yeah. but you want to be out here looking at the reality yeah. to understand the truth and the facts. And I appreciate that about you, and that you understood you needed a PhD to help you do that. Is that important?
It is. At first I thought, you know, maybe why do I need a PhD? Why do I need to learn more? But the thing was that I didn't understand is how it would advance my thinking and how it would cause me to think deeper and consider other possibilities. And I think that process of taking more classes and doing a really intense research project was a valuable skill. And I would really encourage other young creation scientists not to settle, you know, for a bachelor's degree or master's degree, but to press on and continue on. We need people to replace people like myself and Dr. Stelling and Dr. Austin. We're getting older, and we need the new generation to come up and begin to look deeper into some things. We don't know all the answers here yet. I would really like to know how much time is in between that ash bed and that ash bed.
Yeah.
And we need some new scientists out here with some that are trained to think well to work on problems like that.
So would you say that for a young person who is considering one of these scientific areas, that it would be important, number one, to get their doctorate, and it's important for them to understand there's a whole lot of things to be looking at?
Yeah. I think, Del, there's two things that are really important for a young scientist. And number one is to become well-trained. You need to interact not only with other creation scientists, but you need to interact with conventional scientists too. Creation scientists need to understand how the conventional community thinks. And because we want to be able to interact with them and read their literature and talk to them, they have a lot of valuable experience and valuable observations that we can use. But the other thing, Del, is they need to be grounded well in Scripture. So they need to understand a biblical model. They need to understand what the Bible says about these things. And they need to take things like this and put these kinds of things within the record. The biblical record doesn't tell us everything we want to know. It kind of gives us a framework. Mm-hmm. You know, for geology, it talks about the creation, it talks about the flood, and there's not too many other things geologically that we have to work with. We know about how much time that we have to work with and so on. But I think, you know, when we look at rocks like this and do good science, we can find answers that fit within a creationist model.
Are those answers what drives you all as creation scientists? Is that kind of your major objective?
I think scientists are curious, right? I think if we weren't curious, there no science would ever be done. And so we're curious about the fish in these rocks. We're curious about the plants. And, you know, is this a new one? Is this different than that one? You know, why does this fish have an exploded head on it mm-hmm. or, you know, exploded belly? And those were kinds of questions that I wanted to answer in my research. And Through my experiments, I was able to figure that out. The solution was not apparent, you know, when I started. I didn't know why in the world some fish, you know, their heads were blown up and the rest of the fish was perfect. Mm. But, you know, through my experiments and so on, I was able to figure that out. And the scientists that work here at Fossil Butte were very happy that I was able to figure that out, because they were able to answer a lot of questions that people had coming to their museum.
Yeah. Well, I am grateful that you took that path. I appreciate all that you've taught me.
Yeah, it's been fun, Del.
Yeah.
It's really fun.